reading from the book of Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel has the tall cedars of Lebanon as a symbol for the empire that has conquered them. So, tall tree, low tree. Arrogant tree, Tower of Babel. Tall tree of pride, subjugation, oppression, violence, empire. Low tree, God's kingdom. But there's more than that. The mustard bush, mustard is not a tree. Have you ever gone out to, you've just, in Minnesota or North Dakota, you've come across these magnificent yellow fields, or Spain, these magnificent fields of yellow, so magnificent, they take your breath away. And you stop the car and you take a picture because it's so incredibly beautiful. This natural field of yellow mustard. They look like trees to you? I don't think so. It's a shrub. And to those to whom Jesus was telling this story of the mustard tree, they knew that. And they also knew that the mustard shrub was an invasive species that was a pain in the neck. And it grew up right underneath the tall cedars of Lebanon. So listen now. As Jesus, tongue in cheek, and with just a touch of sarcasm, and a twinkle in his eye, and a smile, talks about the kingdom. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if someone should scatter seed upon the ground and should sleep and rise and day, night and day, and the seed should sprout and grow. He knows not how. The earth produces of itself first the blade and then the ear and then the full grain of the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. And, he said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? They're living in somebody else's kingdom, the kingdom of Caesar. With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? Well, it's like a grain of mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet, when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make their nests in its shade. It's a parable of contrast between the cedars of empire, which in the Hebrew scriptures are the places in which all of the nations, like birds, make their nests in its branches. The tree is over everything, and we are all in birds' nests in its branches. Jesus says, you're an invasive shrub. It's an invasive shrub. It's a mustard bush. And in that humble mustard bush, all the nations of the earth, all people, will find rest and their true habitation. I've chosen this morning to share with you something that took place in 2005. I was executive director of the Legal Rights Center at the time. And a 12-year-old girl named Sydney Macock, who was a Menominee Potawatomi, was thrown from a car on the sidewalk by the funeral home on Columbus Avenue in South Minneapolis. She was dead. And so I stood on that spot when I learned of this. I stood there by myself and pondered that piece of land, what had happened to Sydney, and not just to Sydney, but what was happening, what had happened to her people, and what was happening to me and to my people, to our people. And 3 days later, we met at that same spot, and members of the American Indian community and Sydney's family asked me if I would help them to try to bring some meaning out of this senseless death. I share it with you this morning. And keep in mind the tall tree and the mustard seed, although I don't make reference to them. This is exactly what I said. Once upon a time, a proud people lived on this land. They called themselves Ojibwe, Anishinaabe, Dakota, Lakota, and Winnebago. Occasionally, a Menominee from Wisconsin would visit. They lived close to the land. They hunted. They fished. They gave thanks to the Great Spirit for every day. They saw themselves as part of nature. They rose with the sun. And when the sun went down, they gathered in a circle by the light of a campfire. By the light of the campfire, they listened to the elders, whose stories broke the silence to tell the children who they were. The children went to bed in safety. They were people of great dignity. Their ways were good ways. They respected the land. They respected each other. They honored their elders. They cared for their children. They trained their youth to become responsible adults. They died with dignity. They were buried with honor. Earth was their mother. Gichimanitu and Wakantanka, the Great Spirit, was the common grandfather of them all. Then something terrible happened. A plague came over their land. It took their land, it stole their culture, it laughed at their spiritual practices, it called them savages and other names. It tore down their teepees, their longhouses, and their sweat lodges. And in their place, the plague built tall buildings. Big buildings, arrogant buildings, skyscrapers, they called them, that invaded the sky, turning the land into something that it is not. The Ojibwe and Lakota and Dakota who lived there, here, no longer rose with the sun. They no longer gathered around the campfire. They no longer heard the stories of who they were. They knew only what the white plague had told them, that unless they joined the plague, they were nobody, and that if they challenged it, they would lose. They would die. And so they lived in grief, a sorrow too hard to bear, a loss too great to carry. And the plague offered them relief to numbness, to numb their pain, fire water that would make them happy in spite of their despair, drugs to take away the memories of who they had been, escapes to make them numb, to numb the pain, opiates to freeze their tongues and stop their protest. The elders no longer acted like elders. The parents were numb with grief. There were no aunts, no uncles, no cousins, no grandparents. Nobody dared to be a neighbor. The children were left with no campfire at night, no community to tell them the stories of who they were and who they were not. And so the children and the youth drifted out into the night in search of themselves. Locked in lonely prisons of confusion, the youth no longer knew Mother Earth as their mother. They no longer knew how to give thanks to the Great Spirit for the day. They no longer went to bed with the going down of the sun. They wandered the night in search of the community they had lost and never known. And the gangs and the drugs and the alcohol offered them promises of a better life that was the kiss of death. Ecstasy was no longer a way of life. It was a pill that would make you higher than the skyscrapers that ruined the once humble landscape. And sometimes the alcohol and the drugs and the gangs that had promised to numb the pain of the youth took their lives, and they were found in the morning as the sun came up. They were found on the sidewalk by strangers. Then one day, a girl named Sydney, a 12-year-old Menominee Potawatomi, was found beside a funeral home on Columbus Avenue. How she got there, nobody knew. How she died, nobody knew. But everybody knew why. The community had unraveled. It had become dry bones in the valley. But on that day, on the day that the people gathered here on the sidewalk on Columbus Avenue to mourn her death, there was a sound from heaven, a rattling, the sound of dry bones coming together, a resurrection of a once proud but humble community. And as a result, Sidney Macock's tragic death, the community came together as it had not come together since the plague had begun. On that day, they gathered on Columbus Avenue, a street named after the European explorer who had not discovered their land or their country. On that day, the community awakened from its sleep. It came together, Ojibwe, Dakota, Menominee, Potawatomi, Lakota, African-American, Somali, Hispanic, Hmong, and yes, even the descendants of Columbus. And on that day, because of a little girl's unexplained death, they stood together arm in arm and said, enough to this plague, enough to numbness. They said, no more, no more, no more deaths on Columbus Avenue. And it was more than words. They looked up at the sun again, and they saw it, really saw it, as if for the very first time. They looked down at the earth, Mother Earth, and they saw it, as if for the very first time. And they gave thanks. And then they looked at each other, and they said, we are a proud people. We are a humble people. We will take back this land. We will be the people who honor our elders. We will be the people who support the parents and care for the children and our grandchildren. We will be the people who guide the youth. We will be the people of hope, not despair. We will be the people of love, not hate. We are all today, Menominee and Potawatomi, We are all grandchildren of one grandfather. We are the people who care for each other. We are the people who refuse to go numb. We are the people who will teach the children of Columbus, starting right here, right now, on Columbus Avenue, how to live in a good way with Mother Earth, in a good way with Iraq, in a good way with the rivers and the sky, the ozone and the sun. We are the people whose spirituality will help to cure the cancer of the spiritual and economic plague that has left us all in despair. And from that day on, November 4, 2005, at 12 noon, 12-year-old Sydney Macock, our daughter, our granddaughter, our little sister, our friend, our neighbor, would be forever remembered as the one whose deadly silence on this sidewalk spoke so loudly that we could not stay numb. And we took the city back and brought it back to life. Merciful God, Wakantanka Gichimanatu. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Jehovah, Allah, Grandfather, Great Spirit, who breathes life into all things and receives all life at the end. Yours is the air we breathe, the land on which we walk. Assure us that your love is stronger than every power to hurt, divide, or kill. Receive your child, Sydney, into your eternal care. Wrap your arms around her mother, Glenda, around Sydney's brothers and sisters, around all the defenseless children of the night, around all of us who mourn their plight and mourn Sydney's death. Rekindle the light of faith and hope in us. Take from our souls the plague of hate, self-hatred, and despair. Take away the numbness and the apathy. Make us a people of healing, a humble, quiet people, but a proud people of love and spiritual strength, a people not afraid to feel the pain, who really feel the loss, who feel our feelings and do not fear them, a people who dare to believe that every tear that falls from our eyes flows into the common stream of human suffering that leads into the ocean of community restored and at peace, a people secure in the knowledge of your great love. Amen.